Let's visit the 90s all over again. Put on those hammer pants. This is Dope Nostalgia.
Happy New Year to you guys. It is 2022. 2022, finally. And welcome to Dope Nostalgia. I'm your host, Naomi. We got a few different things going on the podcast. A little bit of mix of stuff for you today. The first being my interview with Romy Snoeijers. She was a member of Two Unlimited for a while, and she's also a really popular voiceover actress. So she'll be joining me on the show later. Plus, our good friend James P. White is going to be doing another episode of The Long and Short of It with me, where we go over the top 10 Billboard tracks of a certain year in the 90s. Before we get to that, here's a little background information on our guest today, Romy Snoeijers.
Wikipedia moment.
Romy Snoeijers has been a member of Two Unlimited, as well as doing so many of her own projects, including voiceover work, which she's very well known for. You can check out her webpage at voiceoverromy.nl. She's considered the voiceover of Holland, and she has so many tracks on her YouTube that show you some of the work she's done, one of my favorites being some of the video game work that she's done. There's some awesome tracks on YouTube as well, Two Unlimited tracks featuring Romy, such as Wanna Get Up. There's a track under the name Romy Luma featuring Dimitri and Jamie called Wildest Love. And one that's produced by Two Unlimited member Ray Schlinghardt, who's been on the show. The song is called Hungry for Love. So let's take a little time to get to know Romy. Romy, thank you for being on the show.
Well, I wanted to tell you about the show. It's called Dope Nostalgia, and we talk to people whose careers were very vibrant in the 90s decade and what you're doing now. So we want to talk, we want to inform all the listeners about what you've been up to. And I want to share, your work with the Canadian and the North American audience. So
thank you
for being on the show today. How did you get involved in music in the beginning stages?
Thank you for having me, of course. Mm-hmm. I started singing when I was young, when I was about 12 years old. Mm-hmm. And then I started singing classical, but for me it was a bit boring. And then I tried to sing pop music and rock music, all kind of music. Mm-hmm. And first I just sang in all kind of bands. And then I made records and I wrote my own songs. And I also worked, I did 3 years, I joined a group, Two Unlimited, for 3 years. Mm-hmm. And we toured a lot. We went to Taiwan, to China, to Japan, to India, to Dubai. We toured around the world for 3 years. Mm. But then, of course, and every project is coming in, because then you can never do it your whole life. Only the superstars can do it for their whole life, but there are only a few superstars like Madonna or the Rolling Stones that can do it forever. But most of the people, they can just do it for a few years and then it's done, then the project is done. And so I moved on and I made a record with DJ Tiesto. Mm. And that's called Don't Break My Heart, and it's Romy. Don't Break My Heart, and my name is Romy, so it was released. And and I also I'm still, nowadays I'm still singing. Mm-hmm. And I'm still I'm also, my work is also on voiceover, so I'm doing all kind of voiceovers nowadays, from projects from Ninja Turtle or Frozen, but also very serious things like business, corporate texts, and but also texts for media or all kind of things. So every day I'm still recording in studio, and I still love it because I love to work with my voice, and
yeah,
it's never boring.
No, you have such a wide variety of different things that you can do with voice. So that's wonderful how you've adapted and how you've been successful.
Well, thanks. It's also, for me, it's not work, because for me it's just, I like to play with the voice, and for me it's just second nature. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think about it. I just do it. And it also gives me a lot of freedom because if I'm recording something and it needs to be delivered at the end of the day, it's there at the end of the day. And what I do in between, nobody knows. So if I say, let's go for lunch, or I'm going to do something with a friend or whatever, nobody knows that as long as the audio has been delivered at the end of the day.
Yeah.
So it has a lot of liberty as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's your journalist and also a very comfortable profession.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it allows you that freedom to work at your own pace in some ways, but you still probably have a lot of deadlines that you have to get to, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's true. Deadlines are always there.
Mm-hmm.
So, if I get a job, I always make sure that, you know, I do very early so that I don't end up at the end. So I always have it. I'm always done early because mm-hmm. I don't want to keep the project waiting.
Yeah.
Because then I'm getting so. But it's very nice to do the work as a singer, but also as a voiceover.
Yeah, and yeah, you're being a professional, getting it done on time and everything. I noticed that you did voiceover work for one of my very favorite video games, Civilization VI. So,
I did. Yes, I did. Well, I did Wilhelmina. She was the old queen of Holland. Of course, she died.
Wow.
She talks like this. You know, she's very queenish, and she's old-fashioned. So. The Dutch people. No, I talk like that. The royal, but it's very fun to do.
Mm-hmm.
I also do a lot of animation.
Yeah.
And then small voices like that. You know, all kind of things. It's just very funny to do that.
Yeah.
And I also do the five different characters of the. What's the word again? I lost the word. Wait, I have to think again. Shopkins.
Oh, the Shopkins.
Shopkins. I do five different ones.
Yeah, that's very popular here.
Yeah, Shopkins. I do five. I do chocolate. Oh, chocolate. No, I do all the different five voices in one thing. And it's very cute to do. Like a boy, you know, and then a different one, and then a different one. So it's fun to do that because you can just play with the voices. And
that is so fun. It would be. I would love to get into that over here. Who were your musical heroes when you were growing up? Who were the bands and the artists that inspired you?
Oh, I liked very much Chaka Khan because she, and I also met her.
Wow.
And I shook hands with her, and I embraced her because she has such a beautiful voice, and she's very real. Because what I don't like so much is the artificial the voice that I created, and the girls that I created, like group that has been created by a businessman, you know, because that's so artificial. I like people that are just. That make music because they love to make music.
Mm-hmm.
For example, just an example, for example, Dolly Parton is very authentic because mm-hmm. she is just a self-made woman and she conquered the world. And if you look at somebody like Chaka Khan, she's very authentic, and Tina Turner is very authentic.
Mm.
And but also now people like Ed Sheeran is very authentic. He is just very, he can say everything he wants. And he's just a real musician.
Yes.
And he, you know, he has the music in his blood.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at some bands, there are just beautiful faces and beautiful people created and then put together. And, you know, and then they think, oh, that's a nice girl. Oh, she can sing a little bit, but, you know, and she can dance very well. So do that. But I think the singing is not so much about the dancing. It's about, of course, they need to do the whole show. I understand. I think... if a person can sing very well, I mean, you don't see Ed Sheeran dancing, right?
No.
But he's just a very good performer. He can sing very well. He mm-hmm. can he can play very well. He's just a performer.
Yeah.
And of course, there are people like, for example, Robbie Williams that can dance and can also sing, or Justin Bieber, the man can dance very well. And he can sing also, but it's just like, I like very much the people that are musicians from the heart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you have to do what you're strong at. So maybe you're an amazing singer, but you can't dance. Well, like Ed Sheeran, maybe it's best if you just stick to what you're good at.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and that doesn't matter, because if you can sing and dance, great. But if you cannot, I mean, I don't like the pop groups that are created just to be commercial.
Yeah. Yeah, no.
And feel it. You feel it when somebody sings and it's from the heart and it's a real singer, and you just know that, for example, Prince, he was a real performer. He could do everything. And he could do everything. He could dance. He could sing. He could write. He could produce. He made other stars. He could do everything. He mm-hmm. was just a genius. He could do, literally, he could do everything.
True.
But there are not so many people who can do everything. He was really an exception. Most people can just do one thing or two things, and that's already a lot.
Mm-hmm. What was one of your most memorable performances that you did back in those days? Like a big event or?
We had so many great ones. I remember one time we were dancing in Japan and people just fainted in front of the audience.
Oh, wow.
And they just fainted, you know, and you only had to say, "Ooh," for example, this is a joke, and they already fainted.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just a hype that has been created because the people never had a conversation with me. That's nothing. It was just the hype and the atmosphere that people see you. And then it's not about me, of course. It's about people, the audience sees a pop star. And because of that idea, they already faint.
Yeah.
That's already crazy. You know, why? Why would you faint? I mean, but it's just, unbelievable.
They get very overwhelmed by the moment.
By the moment. They get overwhelmed by the moment. And that's the thing. And most of them are very young, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have a lot of fans that got really hysterical and screaming and crying and writing notes every day and sending us candy and sending us cuddles and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But also we had moments when we had to go in Bangkok that people just, they had to push everybody out of the way. And one time a girl fell because she wanted to get to us. And then she fell in the audience and then she broke her arm. Things like that. Sometimes it's, you know, thank God she was not there. But I mean, some people are just, it's only about the moment. You get overwhelmed by the moment. But it's not really about the person. It's just the hype that it has been created.
Yeah. No, exactly. Yeah. It's like a machine and they get wrapped up in it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. They just create such a buzz and people get local. It's like the new iPhone.
Yeah.
They create such a buzz and then people get completely nuts. that there's coming a new iPhone, but
yeah,
so what? It's just a phone.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I have an iPhone myself. I like iPhones, but I mean, you know, people just get the marketing machine gets them so local.
Yes,
that they do. You know, that they become out of their minds, and that's just very funny to see.
Yeah, and if you had told me 20 years ago that I'd be able to have a computer in my hands with me as a phone everywhere I go, I would never believe it.
Yes, but now you have it.
Yeah,
you
we know? Have it.
Yeah, and it's so great because your profession is pretty amazing. I mean, you have all kind of life stories of everybody.
Mm-hmm.
You can record them, you can rewrite them, you can write them, you can share them, and you know, it's There's nothing more interesting, I think, than to share stories. So, I mean,
mm-hmm.
if it's a story about a person or a work or a project or a dog or a cat or whatever, it's very nice that you can share stories. It's an amazing work you have.
That's why I have the technology to have this this conversation with you, and then we can play it on the show, which is amazing.
Well, I think it's very sweet of you that you invited me.
Oh, of course. I'm glad you've taken the time. I'll just ask a couple more questions before we wrap up. When you were in Two Unlimited, and you said you were there for about 3 years, and then you did the DJ Tiesto project. I'm going to play a clip of that song on the show as well. Where has your music career allowed you to go now besides doing the voiceovers? You're in the recording studio, but are you still making music as well?
I am still making music, but it's more, you know, for the commercial project. So, for example, if they want me to sing something for an animation or they want me to sing something as a jingle, then I will do that.
Mm-hmm.
But to perform with DJs, you know, that's just something, it's very lovely, but it's very late.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a twin now. A boy and a girl that's 10 years old. And, aww. You know, it's also, yeah, so Ibiza is Enta. And, yeah, so it's, you know, it's when you go away, and because I did it for so many years that I came home and then the birds were singing and it was like, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning. And if you do that for years and years,
yeah.
One time, you just go, oh my goodness, I just want to go to bed. You know, I have all this beautiful glitter clothes. And I love to wear them sometimes,
mm-hmm.
but not every time.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes you just want to be in your pajama and you just want to sleep.
Oh, yeah. And then sometimes you want to get up and get dressed and party. Sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes you can do it. And then it's nice. And it's, but if it is a must and you have to perform every time, you have to be there, you have to perform at 2 o'clock in the night,
mm-hmm.
and you have to have all your glitters and beautiful clothes on, all your makeup on, and you're very tired, then you think, oh my goodness, you know, I just want to go to bed.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the thing, if you do that, if it's a party, then you feel excited and you want to go, but if you have to do it every time and it's a must.
Too much.
Then, yeah, and you do that for many, many, many years, and at one point you think, phew, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Now I can just record and have free time, and if I want to sing, I sing, and if you know,
mm-hmm.
so it's just, you know, it's also, I've seen a lot of things, and I've done a lot of things, and
mm-hmm.
you cannot, yeah, some people can, but, yeah.
No, it's,
I also like very much the voiceover work, yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's a nice balance for the for your life, you know? I like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, what country are you residing in now?
I'm now in Spain.
Okay. All right. Now.
Before I was living in France. Yeah.
You were in the Netherlands. Okay.
Yeah. Oh. I were in the Netherlands, but now I'm in Spain.
Beautiful. Now, what are your favorite things about the culture from, I would say, if you're originally from the Netherlands, what's one of the favorite things about the culture there for you and the country and the tourism? What do you like to tell people about who visit your country?
Because Holland very much promoting people to get into music. There are a lot of very good music schools, conservatories, and very good studies and classes, and people are very into music. There are a lot of world-famous DJs in Holland, and people are very driven. In Holland, everything is very organized, like in Canada, of course.
Yeah.
And so people are very focused and very eager it's a very good country to study.
Yeah, I can't wait to visit. I have a couple friends there I've never met yet, so I would love to visit one day.
One day. It's not a very big country. It's, of course, very small.
Yes.
And but it's very structured.
Yeah.
It's very structured, so it's really a working climate there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you have countries where you come to relax and to party, but Holland's very... Really, there. If you receive an email and you got one back within 5 minutes, you know, if you have a gig, everything is organized.
Mm. Wow.
So that's very good.
Yeah, people are working hard.
People are working hard. Yeah, and they're very motivated. So that's good, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, and to wrap things up, I want to ask you, Romy, a question I ask everybody who is on the show. When you think back to the 1990s, that whole decade, is there a food or a clothing item, even a toy, that makes you nostalgic for that decade?
You had the flare pants at that time, right? The flare pants.
Ooh, yes.
That was very funny, I thought. And then it was a nice free area, free time, a very... liberated time. Everybody was dancing with everybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody's welcome. So I think it was a very fun time and a very happy time.
Yeah, I agree. I had an amazing time. And that's gay.
Yeah, gay or not gay, colored or not colored, everybody's welcome. The 90s are very open and liberated. It's like the 60s a little bit.
It was probably a bit more open in Europe, I bet, than it was over here. Canada, yeah, but I know the U.S. has always been kind of more like conservative.
Yeah.
At least it was then, but I think the 90s, a lot of change happened that made everything more open in this continent.
Yeah, that's true, but. I like very much that everybody can be themselves, and that's very nice. That's very nice also. So you cannot be anybody else but yourself, because you
that's
are
right.
yourself. So who can you be?
That's right.
You can't be that.
That's right.
You can only be yourself.
And it's so true, and it's so nice that, you know, everybody is here. We are 30 years later, and everyone feels more free. And it was a good place starting in the 90s.
Yes. Yes, it was. It was. Absolutely.
Well, I'm really thankful that you took the time to talk to me.
Thank you so much, Naomi.
Thank you for your time.
Good luck. Yeah, good luck for you with your show.
Thank you. Big hug to you, too, and you have a wonderful day.
Thank you. The same to you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thanks again.
Take care.
There are moments in life we cannot explain. Life seems to be perfect. I know it sounds insane. Moments for all time, stand still for a while. It seems to be endless, till comes the thought, why?
If you only get closer, and you go away, life is nothing, check and feel me. I feel this way sometimes, you can go forever. Nothing will remain. It's not easy to survive. I'm certain tonight. Don't break my heart. Don't hurt my soul. When you go, you'll break my heart again. So in love with you. If you won't look further, run away just to leave me with myself, babe. I'm searching tonight. Don't break my heart. Don't hurt my soul. When you go, you'll break my heart again. Again, again. Don't hurt my soul. Don't break my heart.
Don't you ever break my heart again. There are moments in life we cannot explain. Life seems to be perfect. I know it sounds insane. Moments for all time, stand still for a while. It seems to be endless, till comes the thought, why? Why?
After these messages, we'll be right back.
It's a conspiracy. Conspiracy.
It's a Conspiracy is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network and happily powered by ATB.
We are a bi-weekly podcast that aims to discuss selected conspiracy theories, alternative accounts, legends, myths, and more without coloring the topic with our conversation until the very end of the episode.
We also feature beer reviews, lame jokes, bad puns, far too many 80s movies references, geek culture, and general nerdery.
Our real aim is for fun, inclusive content that doesn't take itself too seriously.
You don't have to be blisteringly paranoid of mind control to enjoy a chin wag with your old pals, Greg, Charlie, Andrew, the Irish Madman, and our podcast puppies, Kylo and Ren.
It's a Conspiracy is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, powered by ATB.
Dope Nostalgia listeners, I love you and I thank you so much for being a part of this show and its success over the last 2 years. We have what's called Patreon for those who want to support the show financially. For as little as $1 a month, you can become a subscriber and get bonus content, early podcast release, all kinds of cool behind-the-scenes stuff, and more. There's different tiers of membership starting at only $1 a month. And we even have some special merch for you guys who are in it for the long run. So please, join our Patreon. It's at www.patreon.com/dopenostalgia.
Coming this fall, the most anticipated action-adventure epic of the year. A story of one man's struggle to save mankind from extermination and his quest to capture the heart of the woman he loves. If he is to succeed, he will need intelligence, strength, courage. You, on the other hand, will need a PlayStation and lots of free time. Final Fantasy VIII, coming to a home theater near you.
PlayStation.
Welcome to the Billboard Year-End Hot 100 Singles of 1993 with my friend James P. White and me, Naomi. We're going to go through the top 10 of that year, and then we're going to pick which songs were our favorites. Let's start with number 10, Snow Informer. I can't believe that got so high on the American charts, but it did.
But it stands out, though.
It does. It was another one of those white rappers from Canada. Oh, wait, we've only had one big one, but yeah. It did stand out because it was different because of like him singing the way he sang it and or rapped it, you know? And it was a song that was written about him being incarcerated, right?
But the thing is though, with a big song, is people have to remember it. And not one people remember. Mm-hmm. Even 20 years later, people remember that song.
At the time, you don't know what's going to happen for 20 years down the road, but it did fairly stand the test of time. It's even been redone, covered by a new hip hop group, and then Snow made a guest appearance on it as well.
I think the whole point of that song was that it was calling out the person who sent him to jail, the informer.
Yeah.
So he was so badass. All right, number 9. Rex in Effect, Rump Shaker. Do you remember this one, Jimmy?
No.
Here, I'll play you a little clip. I can't even say for sure if you would remember this one, even when you hear it. But we'll get to it here. See, you might have heard it in the DJ days. Baby, check, baby, 1, 2, 3. Check, baby, check, baby, 1, 2. Check, baby, check, baby, 1. It's cool, one shaker. The beach is like sweet and candy. I'm feeling manly and your shake is coming in handy. Slide on my clip, but it plus got a surprise. That's a big boom. Here we go.
I have no idea.
You never heard that one?
No.
Rump Shaker, Rex in Effect. One hit wonder. I don't have much to say about that, but it was a fun one to dance to.
I get that.
But wasn't like super unique or anything, but it was fun. Number 8, Mariah Carey, Dream Lover. I think by the time we got to Dream Lover, I think she was on her 3rd album. Yep. Okay. It was the lead single from her 3rd studio album, Music Box, in 1993. Dream Lover, another huge hit. Everything she was putting out at back then was turning to gold. Like, she probably, honestly, I think it's possible that to this day, she still might be the female artist with the most number one hit singles.
Really?
Of all time. Oh, it was very likely.
It's, but it makes sense though, because she has a very focused voice. She's an amazing singer.
Mm-hmm.
And she can carry a tune.
Like, she's untouchable, darling. She can carry a tune. And she's pretty fun. I love her diva reputation that she has because she just plays into it. When if you actually like look at Mariah Carey, she had a reality show called Mariah's World for a while. And she's actually really funny and kind. So I think she gets a rep as a diva, but she just runs with it and plays with it because why not?
Oh, yeah.
Throwing shade. And but she's actually amazing. I love her. Number 7. The group Shy with the song If I Ever Fall in Love. Is it ringing any bells for you?
The title rings bells.
The very first time that I saw your brown eyes,
you said hello in the sun.
I don't know if there's even music in this song, if it's all a cappella.
I don't know this song. I don't really have a reaction to it.
Straight up a cappella tune. I've seen other R&B groups and other like vocal groups cover it. Like Backstreet Boys has covered that early in their career, at least at appearances and shows and stuff. But it's a classic like musicless song. It's beautiful. And it made it all the way to, like I said, number 7. I don't know, you might not know the, because I'm, like I said, you're a rock guy, right? So,
but also,
a few things you might have missed.
So getting into this era, I was very much Christian rock by this point.
In 1993?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, but the thing is, though, is like in every year that we've played so far, I know songs even now that maybe I didn't listen to back then.
Yeah.
That I know now.
Yep.
That you hear like listening to podcasts or being on radio like
being
I am.
Being on radio. That's the thing, being on radio. Now, you've always worked in rock stations, though. So you probably didn't get a lot of that R&B stuff.
No.
Which makes sense. And I would tell you now that there's going to be a couple R&B tracks coming up. This next one is number 6, is a group called SWV. That stands for Sisters with Voices. And the song is called Weak. I'll play you a little clip of it. Chorus.
I actually really love the way that the lyrics kind of intertwine. Like yeah. it's not even total harmony. It's like intertwined. Like they're all in their.
They're doing their parts. Like
they're doing their part in like it's like wove together. I actually really like that one.
It's a beautiful song. SWV was a really popular female-led R&B group. They did a song called Right Here, and it sampled Michael Jackson's Human Nature, which was really nice too. But those are the two songs I think that were, at least from being in Canada and seeing the charts here, those two were very popular in the R&B world. So SWV is amazing.
What was the name of that song again?
It's called Weak. Weak, yeah. They were originally formed as a gospel group in 1988. But they were one of the most successful R&B groups of the 90s. SWV. Now you're moving on to number 5, top 100 of 1993 with the group Silk. Now, Dope Nostalgia, we just did an episode recently with the dirtiest lyrics of the 90s. And this song was mentioned. This is Silk's song called Freak Me. Let me show you this nasty chorus. Hold on. Here we go. Oh, I think the chorus is right at the beginning. It's naughty.
It's very naughty.
It's a very naughty tune. Hence why we talked about it. It was one of our listener suggestions, actually, which was really cool. But Silk. I don't know much else about Silk except that song. They might have been in the one-hit wonder category. People can correct me if I'm wrong and I don't know what the hell I'm talking about, but... The song number 4 on the list is one of my favorite artists, another R&B artist that you know too, though. Everyone knows Miss Janet. Janet Jackson, That's the Way Love Goes. The lead-off single from her album Janet.
Okay, play a clip just because I need the chills.
Okay. It's such a smooth, romantic, laid-back, hot song.
But she's so good at the smooth.
Very good at it. It's such a good song. What a nice vibe, hey? Oh, isn't it good?
Totally.
Do you know what song kind of sounds like that too, from the same era, was Summertime by DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. Oh, that song will never get old, especially in the summer. I put it on every summer playlist.
Oh, but, it's...
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Oh, it's on my playlist at the bar.
Summertime?
Oh, yeah.
Nice. Oh, it's such a classic. Not to take away from this Janet Jackson song, which we were talking about. Like I said, it came out in the album Janet, which was the first album that was released after her big, huge smash, Rhythm Nation 1814. That is the album that made her a household name. And then when Janet came out, she kind of shed her good girl image and is a very sexy, sensual album. Lots of dirty lyrics. A little shocking for some people, but that was the lead-off single. It wasn't nearly as dirty as some of the other songs on the album.
Oh, no.
But were you a Janet fan?
Her songs fan.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the big Janet fan. Still am. I'm glad I got to see her live. It was not that long ago, actually. Last time she was in Edmonton, I think, was like 5 years ago, 6 years ago. Row 10, man. It was so cool to see a legend, a living legend. But well-deserved placement on that chart. Number three. This is a cool cover. Do you remember UB40?
I may have heard of them.
UB40 put out this cover of a classic song called Can't Help Falling in Love that Elvis had made famous. Did you ever hear the UB40 version of Can't Help Falling in Love?
No. Can't say I have.
It was so ridiculously big that year. That's why it's number three on the chart. It was so freaking big. Now, this is a group that's known for their biggest hit actually being Red Red Wine.
Oh, yeah. 100%.
From the 80s. But then when they put out this one, here, let me give you a little taste of it. Here, let's get into the meat of it.
No, you had me at that.
Here's where it gets funky. Relaxed vocal, hey?
But the funny thing is I could be wrong, but he has a very vocal touch to Stevie Wonder. Like if you actually listen to the way that he sings, the way that he does have a bit of Stevie in him.
He's probably influenced a bit by Stevie then.
Because if you,
I'm not hearing it the way you're hearing it, but I can see where you're going with that.
Because he's got the range and but the transition in the range.
So there's something in that vocal that reminds you of Stevie.
Yes.
He's, I would say, nowhere near the singer that Stevie Wonder is, but
no.
There's hints of
there's a hint. Like, he's not a Stevie.
No, not by any stretch, but I can see what you're going for there, for sure. There's that bit of an influence and a little bit of that sound maybe in his tone. But yeah, it was ridiculous how big that single got. It was overplayed, let me tell you. Ooh, number two, 1993's top 100 was Tag Team with the song Whoop, There It Is. I don't think I need to play that for you.
No, you don't need to play that one.
Tag Team, back again. Check the record. Let's begin. I don't even know if that's what it says, but it's what it sounds like.
So back when I worked with the little person basketball team,
Mm-hmm.
That was one of our songs that we used to warm up to.
Sweet. That one. When you guys
But that was like when we warmed up to that song, it was like early 2000s. But it still was, it got the whole crowd pumped up. And
it's such
It's a pump up tune. It's a
jock jams. It's like jock jams.
Yes.
Warm up the crowd. Shakalaka, shakalaka, shakalaka. Boom. Yes. That was fantastic too. Number one of 1993 is not going to be a surprise to you at all. In fact, this is probably one of the biggest singles of all time. It was written by Dolly Parton. Do you know where I'm going with this?
I know exactly where you're going with this.
From the movie soundtrack to The Bodyguard. It was Whitney Houston's I Will Always Love You, which was number one on the chart for about 16 zillion years or days. It was a huge, huge, huge hit. There's not really anything that can be said about that. And what she did to that song was spectacular. And Dolly is a big fan of, she touched that song and made it her own too, right?
Yeah.
Plus that got bank for Dolly Parton. Holy shit. Like she must've made, wonder how much of Dolly's income, considering she has a massive career of her own, how much of that is from that song?
I think that song, how big it was, but how many hits she's had and like duets she's done. And it's, I say in her, I say about,
I'm going to say 10%, you're going to say? I definitely would think that there's millions of dollars involved with that song that she might have made as the songwriter. And she's the only songwriter from what I understand. So that's profit, not split.
But with her doing the song with Kenny, Islands in the Stream.
Oh, she did tons of songs with Kenny.
But that one by itself, I'm pretty sure...
big
fact checking charity. Check this shit out.
Fact checking charity. Here's what I found out. In the 90s alone, Dolly Parton made $10 million US from the song I Will Always Love You. And those earnings have only grown through the decades. Currently, every time a song she wrote is played, she earns approximately 8 cents US and $2 for every album sold.
Big money. Another thing I'd say about that... what was I going to say? Dolly Parton definitely has money, and I'm going to say it had a lot to do with that song, because Dolly Parton's one of the lead people who actually helped fund the research for the Moderna vaccine.
Oh, I know.
Like she put, I don't know, at least $1 million into the research, right?
Yeah.
Something like that. So Dolly Parton's doing all right. I'm sure that this song had a lot to do with it. And it's such a sad fucking thing that Whitney Houston isn't on Earth anymore. But man, a lot of the good ones have gone. Now, when you look at this list, top 10 of 1993, what would you pick for your favorite, James? There's a lot of R&B on this history, on this list, right?
Like, all I'm sorry, I have to go with the actual number one. I'll Always Love You.
Don't be sorry. It's a wonderful choice.
But it's
a lot of people would agree with you.
It's such a powerful song, like especially done by Whitney, mm-hmm. and coinciding with the soundtrack and the way that it was done that way. Like I watched that part in the movie where she sings that song. It brings the one lonely tear.
Yeah.
Only one.
Yeah, the amount of emotion she's singing with in that whole thing moves people. People remember every single run she made, vocally, like it's just, it's, the song was perfected by her. I'd like to point out though, I think she performed it at the Oscars, to open the Oscars, and her voice cracked, and it was the greatest thing ever because it made Whitney human.
But that's always good.
Yeah, it humanized her.
Because you can't edit live.
Although they definitely didn't for that.
No.
But it's okay if she makes a crack. We're only human. We can't be perfect. Like, we're going to make vocal mistakes.
No, I'm always perfect, but...
You know. Except you. Yeah, obviously, yeah. Mr. Perfect.
Because I don't sing.
My number one from this list, I'm going with Janet Jackson, That's the Way Love Goes. Janet was just like a big part of my discovery of the music I love. And when that album came out, I was crazy for it. So I'm going with Janet Jackson. And it's such a smooth, laid back tune. Feels good. It still sounds good. The sound to me is not dated. Just a totally enjoyable tune. Groove along to that anytime. Road trip. At the pub, wherever you name it. So there you go, folks. That is the Hot 100 of 1993. Cut it out. We did a lot. That was a lot.
Fast as fast can be, you'll never catch me.
Unless you follow us on Twitter at NostalgiaDope, Instagram at Dope_Nostalgia. Visit our website at www.dopenostalgia.com or pick up the phone and call us at 780-851-8785 and cut it out.
This podcast is licensed by SoCan because we believe that artists should be paid for their work.